الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده. فاللهم صل وسلم على نبينا وحبيبنا وشفيعنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى أصحابه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة وصاحبها في النار. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in Surah Al-Imran, كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. You are the best community which has been brought forth for mankind. You command what's proper and forbid what is improper, and you believe in Allah. Last time we started talking about human rights in Islam, and we discussed the first human rights declaration that was enacted by Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam in al-Madinah. And we talked about the five basic rights for any citizens who lives under the Islamic State. And when I say the Islamic State, I'm talking about the actual Islamic State. I'm not talking about what they call ISIS. Okay? So we talked about the five basic rights, which is the right to live, the right for practicing religion for all citizens, regarding of their religions or sects, the right of education or intellect, the right to have family, getting married, and the right to have wealth or to have a job. And I ended by talking about commanding what is proper and forbidding what is improper, and I had to cut it short. And unfortunately, I was misunderstood because it was cut short. And on that same day, one brother was insulted by another brother at the end of the prayers. And the other brother pointed the finger at him, like, you don't do that. And like kind of threatening him and embarrassed him in front of people. And even though that was the last thing I talked about, but obviously it went from one ear and out from the other. And that's why one brother also recommended and advised me, knowledgeable brother, to repeat it so people don't misunderstand me. But in general, if we claim we are the people of the truth, when one of us make mistakes, we don't go and yell at them in front of people. We don't go and humiliate them in front of people. Especially on that day, I was talking about human rights in Islam, that we don't humiliate each other. Allah elevated us to be honorable people. Yet the brother went and humiliated the other brother in front of other people. So we need to follow the procedure that the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam did, the way the Ahlul Bayt did, the way the Sahaba did, you know, like by proper advice. Like you take them in the side, you did this mistake, and you teach them properly. If we claim we are the people of the truth, okay? But obviously, I don't even know if the brother is here, because I don't see him. But that's a huge mistake. When we talk about the commanding what is proper and forbidding what is improper, it starts with us having the correct idea, the correct theory, the correct facts of Tawheed, of monotheism. The way Allah revealed it to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, the way Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam taught it to his companions, the way his companions taught it to the followers. Because having this monotheism, a true concept of Tawheed, this is our foundation. This is where everything is built on, including the pillars of Islam. If this idea of Tawheed, of monotheism, is tainted, honorable morals, complete honorable morals, cannot come out or emerge from it. And if you notice, any one of us when we go and learn fiqh or Islamic jurisprudence under any scholar or under any madhab from the madhahib, the first thing they teach us is the Bab al-Tawheed, the chapter of monotheism. Why is that? Because this is the foundation of Islam. Everything is built from there and everything emerges from there. You have this concept, this idea being tainted, nothing good is going to emerge from it. Nothing good. Okay, so to be part of the people who command proper and forbid improper, you have to be among the people of actual people of Tawheed with the correct creed. Because from it emerges, like we said, the honorable morals and the correct Islamic laws, and all together from it we have the correct Islamic system. And also remember, if we're going to claim that we are among the people of commanding what is proper, we have not to forget about the rights of Allah. And one of the major rights of Allah is the proper message of monotheism. Okay, this is the first right of Allah of Allah's rights on us. We have to worship Him properly, the way it was revealed to the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, and the way Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam taught us. Well, Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam did say and order us, والذي نفسي بيده لتأمرن بالمعروف ولتنهون عن المنكر أو لو شكن الله عز وجل أن يبعث عليكم عذابا من عنده ثم تدعونه فلا يستجاب لكم. You must enjoin the good and you must forbid the evil, or Allah will make sovereign over you the worst of you, who will afflict you with the worst of punishment. Then the best of you will make supplication, will make dua, and it will not be answered. This is actually how we, this is what's happening to us right now. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam being very specific, when he says لَتَأْمُرُنَّ, this lam in تَأْمُرُنَّ, he's emphasizing, stressing to you must enjoin the good. And the lamb also in the latanhauna, he's emphasizing that we have to forbid what is wrong or what is evil. So this hadith, according to the consensus of the scholars from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the hadith is a rejection for those who claim that today the only action possible is to make supplication for the victory and the change of situation of Muslim Ummah without any other action being taken. Okay, so in another word, we have to say something about it. We have to do something about it. Obviously, I'm talking peacefully. Okay, we have to expose the falsehood. And another thing that Islam gave us right to is the freedom of thought and expression to all citizens of the Islamic State on the condition that it should be used for the propagation of virtue and truth and not to spread evil and wickedness. So the concept that the West have, that we can, you know, freedom of expression, that you can do and write anything, you can put whatever pictures you want and these things, this is absolutely rejected by us under the freedom of speech. Freedom of speech is within the limits of Allah. Allah does not like His limits to be violated. Okay? But other than that, we have freedom of speech. So the right of freedom of expression for the sake of propagating virtue and righteousness is not only a right in Islam, but an obligation. On the, that's where, like we said, there has to be a group of people. And we did mention last time that this group of people have to be in the community or a country, because it's fard kifaya. Otherwise, the whole community or country will sin. So the one who tries to deny this right, whether this one is un-Islamic groups that we have right now in the Muslim countries or tyrant regimes that we have, anyone who tries to deny this right to the people is openly in war with Allah. Okay? Because it's a command from a Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, we have to command what is proper and to forbid what is improper. والله سبحانه وتعالى says in سورة الحج الذين إن مكناهم في الأرض أقاموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة وأمروا بالمعروف ونهوا عن المنكر. If we, the we here is in reference to Allah, if we give authority to these men on earth, they will keep up prayers and give regular alms, bid what is proper and forbid what is improper. So if they are well established on earth, okay, they will not prevent prayers from happening. We see in the Muslim countries, like we mentioned last time, masajids are being destroyed. Okay? Churches are being destroyed. Also, the zakats are not being ordered from people to pay the zakat, to pay their alms. And it's been proven through scientists and economists that if every Muslim pays his zakat, is not only there will not be any poor Muslim on earth, there will not be any poor person on earth if all of us pay our zakat. Obviously, this is not happening until today. And they order what's, like we mentioned, we keep mentioning, order what is proper and prevent what is improper. But unfortunately, we have groups on the falsehood, whether they are extremists who, like Sheikh Osman in his article said, hijacked Islam, or the tyrants, because both of them are on the same side of the falsehood, they want to invent a new kind of Islam that they want us to follow. Okay? And they want us to stay away from the side of the truth. So if any group or any government deprives the citizens from the right, from this right of expressing, exercising the right of speech and performing this duty to propagate what is right, then that group or that regime is in direct conflict with the injunction of Allah. Well, Allah also says in Surah An-Nisa, لا يحب الله الجهر بالسوء من القول إلا من ظلم وكان الله سميعا عليما. God does not love evil talk in public except where injustice has been done. For Allah is He who hears and knows all things. A lot of people who likes to say things on behalf of Allah and on behalf of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, take this ayah, cut it in half, and give the first part of it. Okay? Which is, God does not love evil talk. So whatever I'm talking to them, to a lot of people, is considered an evil talk. But they don't continue the sentence. They don't continue the verse, which is that Allah is saying, except where injustice has been done. So He's ordering us to say something when injustice has been done. Okay? But unfortunately, people try to mislead us by saying, oh, don't say bad things. This is taboo to talk about these things. No, there is nothing taboo to talk about injustice. You have to expose oppressors where they exist. You have to expose the falsehood where it exists. And we have to do it in a peaceful manner. So this ayah clearly and strongly disapproves the abusive language or strong words of condemnation, but the person who has been the victim of injustice or tyranny, God gives him the right to openly protest against the injury that has been done to him. If anyone tries to usurp this right of any citizen, then he rebels against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So lack of pride and dignity, integrity or humanity, mercy and injustice is a menace to the world peace. And it starts from the top, then it trickles down. Whether the top is these groups who claim they are Islamic groups and they are not, okay, they are just militant fascist groups, or these tyrant regimes. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من دعا على من ظلمه فقد انتصر. Whoever make dua against those who inflict them with oppression, Allah will give him victory. Of course, on the terms of Allah. And we have, from history, some cases of individuals. I mean, I can't mention all the stories. But, I mean, we are in the occasion of Ashura. And one of the important persons that had injustice put on him is Imam Hussein ibn Ali, radiallahu anhu. When he was betrayed by people, and oppression was put on him, and on that day, on the 10th of Muharram, he was martyred, along with other people from the Ahlul Bayt. A lot of people from Ahlul Bayt were martyred on that day, and other Muslims. Okay, and that's because Imam Hussein ibn Ali was very courageous to stand up for oppression. Okay, he understood Islam the way his grandfather, Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, taught it to him. And he stood up for it. And he did not want to take it down and let it go without saying something about it. And because of that, he was betrayed. and oppression was put on him, and it was killed. He was killed. And on that occasion, I like to remind people also that it's from the Sunnah of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. It so happened that Imam Hussein ibn Ali died on that day, the 10th of Ashura. But the reason we fast on that day, because it's Sunnah of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam to fast that day. And it removes the sins from the year before. And I'm going off tangent from the subject. We don't fast because it so happened that Imam al-Hussein radiallahu anhu died on that day. Okay, we fast because we follow the Sunnah of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, and the reason the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam fast this day is because that's the occasion when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa and the Israelites from the pharaohs. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasalam said if he lived the following year, he would fast the 9th and the 10th of Muharram to differentiate the Muslims from the fasting of the Jews and the Christians on that day. Another example from an imam that talked about oppression is Imam Ahmad radiallahu anhu. During his time, the school of Mu'tazila and Jahmiya became very famous. And they were talking about the creation, that the Quran is not the words of Allah. The Quran was created. And unfortunately, Al-Khulafa Al-Abbasiyin, Al-Ma'mun, Al-Mu'tasim, Al-Mansur adopted this doctrine from Al-Mu'tazila. Well, Imam Ahmad stood against it because he considered that kufr or shirk, because the Quran clearly is the words of Allah. So they put Imam Ahmad in jail, and he spoke against his oppressors, and they put the followers of Imam Ahmad in jail. And while being in jail, Imam Ahmad was making dua against the oppressors. And one of his jailers asked him, "Does that include me?" The jailer is asking Imam Ahmad. And he said, "Yes, it includes you, because if it wasn't for you, they wouldn't have been oppressing people." We have to remember that these tyrant groups and these tyrant regimes, if it wasn't for people helping them, whether these people are financing them with money, or these people are the army, or the police, or the judicial system, or the media, whatever, if it wasn't for them, they wouldn't be able to dare to be oppressors. Okay, so these oppressors, just like the Quran describes Fir'aun and his soldiers. The soldiers doesn't necessarily mean soldiers with weapons. It could be, media, it could be people that finance these oppressors. But the point is, objecting to oppression is not fitna or civil strife, like some people try to convince us. It's an obligation on a group of us. Otherwise, we would be all sinners. So instead of insulting the groups who enjoin the truth and forbid the falsehood and expose the falsehood and expose the tyrants from all groups, whether they are the un-Islamic militant groups or the tyrant regimes, give them proper advice when they make mistakes. Strengthen them, encourage them, and because they are doing the Ummah a favor. Fitna is asking for stability without freedom, dignity, integrity, and justice, which negates our nature, and we would be living a life of worthlessness and humiliation, as if we were in big jail, and we are in big jail in the Muslim countries. Freedom without honorable morals, in the other hand, and Islamic law, will lead us to chaos and anarchy, and eventually cause instability. So we are not causing for open-ended freedom, and we are not calling for stability without freedom. So what we need, Islam is a perfect religion. Because you have some ignorant people look at Islam, going back to Islam, as being backward. Or say, well, do a renaissance in Islam, wal-ayyadu billah. Islam does not need renaissance. What needs renaissance is us. We need renaissance to go back to our origin, to go back to the teaching of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, how he taught his sahaba, how they taught the followers. To go back to the glory that we used to have 400 years ago. Okay? Now, I'm not talking to go back to the days of camels and horses and these things. I'm talking about our creed, our aqidah. There is a lot of gray areas, or what's called the public interest in Islam, that changes with the change of time. And we have scholars in the Ummah that know to agree on what is halal and what is haram on these things. But when I talk about going back to the origin, we're going back to the origin of our aqidah, our creed, our monotheism. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروا أنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Allah also says in the Quran, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء. O mankind, keep your duty to your Lord who created you from single person, created of like nature his mate, and from them twain scattered like seeds, countless men and women. And I'm gonna quote a scholar who pondered about this very state, saying, it is believed that there is no text, old or new, that deals with the humanity of the woman from all aspects with such amazing brevity, eloquence, depth, and originality as this divine decree in Islam. So when we talk about human rights, we cannot leave the rights of women alone. We have to talk about women's rights when we talk about human rights, because that was also part of the declaration of human rights that the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam enacted in Al-Madinah, and it was also part of his speech, in his farewell speech. So when he arrived in Medina, he talked about it in his declaration, and in the last speech, the farewell speech, he mentioned the rights of women by saying, be God conscious in your dealings with women, for they are entrusted with you. So I'm not going to talk about the right of education because I talked about it before. So we know women have the right of education, but they also have every aspect of life, of right, just like men. They have the same rights, whether it's rights of property, rights of inheritance, right of business dealings, even and some sort of government. Every aspect of life, they have the same rights as men. The only place where Allah differentiated between men and women is He differentiated between both of them in nature. Okay, even in today's society, even in the US, if you take a look at the health care that Obama passed, he passed extra laws for women because for the protection of women because of them having different nature. Okay, so we all recognize that there is different nature between us and women. So, but other than that, They have the same obligations, the same charitable acts, the same freedom of speech, the same freedom of ownership, rewards, and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلْنَحْيَيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً وَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Whoever does righteousness, whether male or female, and has faith, we will surely cause them to live a good life. Okay, so clearly Islam, and it's from the story, and if we go back from the stories of al-Sahaba, the story of al-Khulafa al-Rashideen, and all through the Islamic Ummah, al-Khulafa, they gave a lot of rights to women. And we did mention when we talked about education that we had a lot of women scholars, whether scholars in life sciences or religion, and they were leaders in the community. Okay, so there is nothing wrong with it. The only no disagreements among the scholars. The first thing is her rights to her family first, but as long as it doesn't conflict with her duties to her family, she has every right to do whatever Islam gave her the right to do. But unfortunately, these days, ignorant Muslims, all they do is take this part of ayah from Surah An-Nisa, which is الرجال قوامون على النساء. Men are protectors and maintainers of women. Actually, if you use the word in Arabic, the word in Arabic, it makes it sound like men are first class and women are second class. Even though the exact translation for it is not that. The exact translation for it is men are the protectors of women. And again, they don't take the whole ayah, they take part of it. The whole ayah says, بِمَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ وَبِمَا أَنفَقُوا مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. So men are the protectors and maintainers of women because Allah has given them, meaning men, more strength than the other, than women, and because they support them for their means. Okay? So if we look at any verses that Allah mentions men, this is where we get the quality of the manhood from the Quran, that we are supposed to protect the women, not to take them as slaves and second-class citizens. And another ayah that a lot of men take from Surah Al-Baqarah and take only, you know, the last part of the ayah, which is وَلِلْرِجَالِ عَلَيْهِنَّ دَرَجَةً. Okay? And this, which means that but men have a degree of advantage over them, over women. And this part of the ayah came as part of the divorce ayah, that if a woman has a baby, is pregnant, that she has to declare what's in her womb to her husband or the man who's gonna about to divorce her, because it's his right to return her back, because he has to spend money on her and support her and her baby. So the ulama said, from this ayah, Allah gave men and women similar rights from this ayah, and he gave the men a greater degree of responsibility over the women, that of women over men. So careful reading of that verse in Arabic and the context of other verses does not imply inequality. Allah will not create women for us to subjugate women and for us to treat women as slaves and to take them as second-class citizens. Because if whoever claims that is saying indirectly that Allah is not just, وَالْعَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ, or that the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, who was sent to as mercy for all world, is unjust. Whereas the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam reminded us all the times to be God conscious with our women. And we remember the story of Dawla during the Khalifa al-Mu'tasim, when the Romans kidnapped a woman from a city that is close to what we call today Anadolu, close to Turkey or in Turkey. And they did not only kidnap one woman, they kidnapped a group of women. And that particular woman screamed from the top of her lungs, "Wa mu'tasima." And the news reached to the Khalifa al-Mu'tasim in Baghdad, and he sent an army to free that woman and the other woman. So what are we doing to the women that we today? Look at what's happening to our women in Myanmar from the Buddhists, from the monks. Look what's happening to our sisters in Middle Africa from the Christian fanatics. Look what's happening to our Muslim women in the Muslim countries, whether it's in Egypt, Syria, Iraq, Somalia, Sudan. All through, from who? From the regimes themselves. Because they get fatwas, and even Iran, they get fatwas from their scholars of the Sultan, that these women, because they're opposing the tyrants, they are not regular citizens. They consider them khawarij. And because they are khawarij, they are considered sabaya, concubines. And that's not considered rape, in their opinion. Okay? So they act as if Islam has loopholes. And who has the loopholes is themselves. Their hearts and their minds have loopholes. When Allah puts His wrath on a community, on a country, on an individual, the first thing He takes away from us is mercy from our hearts. Okay? And this is exactly what's happening in the Muslim countries. We have Muslim women in Palestine, in Al-Aqsa, as third line of defense, defending Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. Okay? Because the first line are men, they getting killed or put in jail. The second line are the youth, getting killed or put in jail. And the third line of defense are women, with their shoes. They take their hijab off, they beat them up, and they got fatwas from their rabbis that you can rape them, but they don't rape them. But subhanallah, the ones who get the fatwas from Shaykh al-Sultan, they apply the fatwa, mashallah. Okay? So we have women defending Al-Aqsa. Why? For lack of men in leadership in the Muslim countries. We have distorted images of male figure in the Muslim countries. Are not able to defend our Islamic shrines and are not able to defend our women. Thousands of women in the Muslim countries or in Myanmar or in Middle Africa are screaming from the top of their lungs why Islamah and nobody is sending an army for them to free them. And then what are we doing? And then you got this un-Islamic militant group came up with the most vicious bid'ah I've ever heard, most vicious innovation, which is called jihad al-nikah. They take women from one soldier to another, and they came up with this bid'ah that it's okay, that's not being a concubine even, or sabaya. This is what we are doing to our women. We forgot what the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam told us. And if I tell you what's happening to our Muslim sisters in Iraq, some of you will have a heart attack. Go and read the reports on human rights of what's happening to our sisters in Iraq, in jail. The other day in Iran, a Muslim sister was executed. Why? Because she defended herself from someone who was trying to rape her. So she killed him. In Islam, she was supposed to be exonerated and she's innocent, she's out. No, they executed her. This is what's happening to our Muslim sisters. And we are the first one that gave women their rights. Most Europeans and all women in the world up to the beginning of the 17th century were jealous of our Muslim women, of how much rights they used to have. Look how we're treating them right now. Is it a mistake in Islam? No, there is no mistake in Islam. Islam is perfect. There is no loopholes in Islam. Islam is perfect. There is loopholes in our hearts. The mistake is in us, it's not in Islam. And that's why we have to stand up and speak against the falsehood. There is nothing taboo about talking about these subjects. Because if we don't, these people who are oppressors, whether the un-Islamic militant groups or the tyrant regimes, will think they are on the right track if we don't expose them. So we need to expose them if we believe we are on the side of the truth. And we have to do it in a peaceful manner. I would like to remind you of the hadith of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam when Jibreel alayhi salam came down to him and told him, Ya Muhammad, ash ma shi' fa innaka mayyit. O Muhammad, live as long as you wish, you shall die. Wa ahbib man ahbab fa innaka mufariquh. And love whoever you want to love, you shall depart. You shall depart him or her. Wa amal ma shi' fa innaka majziyun bih. And do whatever you want to do, you shall be rewarded accordingly. So if you want to take a corner on the side and don't want to say anything or do anything to support the oppressed in the Muslim countries, do whatever you want to do. You shall be rewarded accordingly. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said, I'm sorry, then Jibreel alayhi salam said, Ya Muhammad, sharaf al-mu'min qiyam al-layl wa izzahu istighna'ahu an-nas. That Jibreel alayhi salam said to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, O Muhammad, that the honor of a Muslim is to do the late night prayers, and his pride is to never need people in his life. And know that Allah ordered us to send prayers on Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam when he says in the Quran, Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار O Allah, protect our Muslim sisters and the oppressed in the Muslim countries. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا إن بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب اللهم لا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا سبحان ربنا رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وآخر الصلاة
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله